Well, good morning. My name's Adam Smith, calling from Nobel Media in Stockholm. Would it be possible to speak to James Rothman, please?
Yes, it is. Just a moment. Nobel
Media in Stockholm. Okay, hello?
Oh, good morning. Professor Rothman.
Speaking.
My name's Adam Smith, calling from Nobel Media in Stockholm. We have a tradition
of... Yes, Jeroen warned me that you would be calling. And he was... And also, he also said he would be kind enough to give me 10 minutes to take a shower, and I've done that, so I've collected myself.
Perfect. Gosh. You haven't had long to do so. What were you doing when the call came from Joran?
I was sleeping, actually, not surprisingly.
And what was your first thought on hearing the news?
That at this time, in this day, I was completely shocked and surprised.
Marvelous. Marvelous.
The truth is that anyone, almost anyone who receives a Nobel Prize has some indirect knowledge of one sort or another that they might be a candidate. And so, you know, at some level it's not a complete surprise, but that it actually happens is an out-of-body experience.
And do you think you're going to relish the onslaught of press attention that follows this?
No, actually not. But the opportunity to be a spokesman for the field and for medical science, I do welcome that.
Yes, I imagine that's the big opportunity. It really highlights the field you work in, cell biology in general.
Have you talked to Randy Shekman yet?
Not yet, no. I just tried...
Actually, I was just on the phone with him. He gave me a call. I want to say that I'm absolutely delighted to share this award with Randy Shekman and Thomas Sudhoff. Absolutely and genuinely delighted.
I mean, together you're credited with taking the field of vesicle trafficking from a descriptive to a mechanistic level. And the citation describes, it uses the word machinery to describe vesicle traffic. Is that how you think of it when you think of the cell moving molecules around in vesicles? Do you think of it as a machine?
That is a very perceptive question. That is exactly how I think about it, machinery.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. And the reason is that one of the major lessons in all of biochemistry, cell biology, and molecular medicine is that when proteins operate at the subcellular level, they behave in a certain way as if they were mechanical machinery. It's absolutely fascinating. When we study chemistry, the rules of chemistry, electrons, and so on, they operate at an even smaller level of atoms and molecules. But when you get to the sort of level of the nanoscale, you find that these objects start behaving as if they were mechanical. And it's exactly how I think about it, and I always have.
It's a beautiful picture.
And actually, my orientation originally was in physics. I was trained as a physicist. As a young man, and what so attracted me about molecular biology was the way the opportunity to find simplicity through that very simple concept. It's guided me. It's funny you should ask that at the outset. It's very perceptive of you.
Well, thank you. But in a week or two's time, when things have quietened down, I hope we'll have a longer conversation where we can dig into this more. But just one question. What gave you the courage to embark on this study in the first place? Because the initial experiments, it wasn't clear that they'd work at all.
No. I mean, I don't know. You probably have the benefit of the press release,
mm-hmm.
which I do not. Okay. So I don't know quite how the committee has written this story. But yes, there were in the earlier years when I started this project at Stanford University. Everybody told me that it was nuts to go and try to reproduce the complexities of that mysterious complexities that occur in a whole cell in a cell-free extract. But my courage came from three sources, I would say. The first, in all seriousness, was youth, because there's a certain arrogance in youth. I don't know if I'd have had the courage to do that today. The second was the fact that you could in those days in the United States, you could do adventurous things with very little or no preliminary data, and you could still get support from the NIH to do it. And so in today's environment, I doubt very much I would have had the freedom or the opportunity to truly pursue this. And the third, frankly, was I was inspired by a man named Arthur Kornberg. And Arthur Kornberg is a name that should come up in your interviews, because Randy Scheckman was Arthur's PhD student.
Indeed, yes.
And Arthur, as you know, unfortunately died a few years ago, was one of the great biochemists of the century, the 20th century. And he was the reason why I was at Stanford in the first place, why I left medical school, and the opportunity to be in his department and have the lab next door. And the reason Arthur was such an inspiration is that in his own time, he had conquered an unbreakable barrier for enzymology, as he called it, which was the synthesis of DNA. And so I frankly got a lot of courage, encouragement from being in that environment and watching what Arthur and others could do. I guess that's the answer, my answer to your question.
It's a beautifully succinct answer. Thank you very much indeed. Well, as I say, I will schedule a longer interview with you in the coming week. But for now, I just should let you get on with what will be an extraordinary day.
Anyway, good luck with your interviews with the other laureates today.
Thank you.
And I'll look forward to speaking to you at greater length on another occasion.
Thank you very much indeed. Pleasure to speak
Thank
to you. And once again, congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Thanks. Bye-bye.